As I was saying, I'm going to tell you about some works done in collaboration with Dario Villamena, who is a postdoc in the physics department at École Normale in Paris. Simona Coco, that you just heard in the talk before the break. And Martin Veit, who is in the Center for Quantitative Biology at the Université Pierre and Marie Curie in Paris. So the talk will be about some kind of combination of empirical and analytical tools, or let's say work, we have done in to estimate the top component or the principal component of correlation matrix from the knowledge of empirical correlation matrix. So what do I mean by that? So assume, for instance, you have a set of Gaussian variables which are correlated, and you know the population covariance matrix. Now draw randomly some numbers of configuration of this variable, realizations, and compute the empirical sample correlation matrix. So from the knowledge of this sample correlation matrix, what can you say about the top component, the top principal component with the largest eigenvalue, for instance, of the population covariance matrix? That's the question we are asking. So obviously, this problem has been looked at in the random matrix theory literature for some time. And I will mention briefly some works related to this problem. But I would like first to start with some motivation. And that's not very original after the last two talks we just heard this afternoon. But the motivation came from the study of protein data. And you will see why we looked at the top component. Actually, I should say the bottom component, as you will see in a couple of minutes. And you will see what kind of information we got from this empirical study and how it can help in order to infer the principal components and how that led to the analytical framework I will show. So first, I will start with this kind of biological motivation. And then I will briefly remind you of some properties of the spike covariance model we already heard about yesterday. But the properties I will mention are properties related to the eigenvectors, not the eigenvalues. So they are maybe a little bit less well known. And then I will ask the question, can we infer the top component of this covariance matrix when we are in the strong noise regime, that is in below the so-called BBP threshold, where in principle, it's very hard to do. And you'll see how the use of prior information can help. OK, so the motivation I will be very brief, because we already heard two talks by Lucy and Simona about that. But just let me remind you briefly the problem. So we have data which are sequences of amino acids corresponding to a set, to, let's say, to different but similar proteins. That's basically proteins having very similar function in different organisms and having a common evolutionary origin, common ancestor. And if we observe this set of letters here, so we may have 20 different letters, or 21 if we include gaps, because not all sequences have the same length, so we need gaps in order to format all this set of sequences here, then we observe that there might be some pairwise correlations, or even higher order correlation between the different columns here. That means that the mutations or evolution of the different amino acids at different sites might not be independent. And one reason why we may have this correlation here is comes from the three-dimensional structure. Amino acids which are far away along the primary sequence may be close to each other in three-dimensional space and are likely to evolve in a non-independent way, as we heard about in the last two talks. So the idea of, let's say, exploiting the pairwise correlations in order to say something about the structure is not a new idea. Actually, it was proposed 20 years ago, even more than that. But so what people did at that time when they started to have, let's say, a bunch of sequences corresponding to interesting proteins, they look at these pairwise correlations. And as was explained in the previous talks, and this is a picture that Simona already showed to you, for a protein that's a small trypsin inhibitor protein. So it's a protein which inhibits digestion in bovines. And these small proteins, what you see is that if you look at the top, I think, I don't remember, 20 or 30 correlations here, which correspond to, so you see the three-dimensional structure here, and you see links which correspond to the top correlations. And when you do that, you see that many of them actually do not correspond to contact, the green ones, simply because You may have high correlation, which are mediated by intermediary amino acid or sites, and that do not correspond to real interaction. So what was proposed in the past years is actually to use some kind of maximum entropy modeling in order to improve this description. And the idea is that we look for a model, like some kind of POTS model that Simona told about, and Lucy too, which reproduce the 1 and 2 point statistics. So this model has some kind of interactions, this JIA, JB, which tells you, let's say, what is the contribution to the log likelihood of a given sequence if you put amino acid A on side I and amino acid B on side J. So you need a large number of these pairwise interaction parameters in order to describe your model, and you need also single site parameters, which are the local fields. So there are many, many such parameters, and of course, the number of data might, for some families of proteins, be not so large. So what people have done is, look to simpler cases where you have less parameters to fit, and one way to do that is to introduce some priors over the parameters, these couplings here. So one way, as Simona said, was, for instance, to put some L2 regularization so that you have less, or let's say, that can help. But I mean, what we have done recently was to try to do some kind of low rank approximation for couplings. There is no very good reason to do that. There is no reason to assume that this matrix is low rank. So it will be only an approximation. But the idea is very simple. If you have this protein, which is of length n, so you have n amino acids. Each amino acid can have 20 plus 1, 21 different values, if you want. So we are in a space of dimension 21 times n. And we are looking at some directions in this space which are favorable. That means that a sequence, which is a bunch of ones and zeros in this space here, will have a tendency to align along this direction. So if you have a vector corresponding to a sequence which is aligned along this particular good direction, that means that the corresponding sequence is likely to have the right fold and maybe the right function. So there might be attractive directions, which we call patterns here. And there might be also repulsive ones, directions which are not good at all, so that the sequence would like to be as orthogonal as possible. So you see that the two kind of things happen. And the question is, can we infer this direction? So mu is the index it's the label of a direction, and IA are the sites and the amino acids. So just to cut a long story, if you do this maximum likelihood inference, what we find is something very simple in the simplest setting, simplest approximation, mean field approximation, is that essentially this direction here, so you see component IA of direction mu, will be proportional to the mu-th eigenvector of the Pearson correlation matrix of the alignment. So with the alignment here, we can compute the pairwise correlation and the Pearson correlation. And up to some normalization factor here, which is the square root of the frequency of having amino acid A on psi I, then we get this factor. So lambda mu here is the eigenvalue corresponding to the eigenvector mu, and we get this simple result. So what happens here is that just I would like to remind you that the couplings here are just a product of psi I A, psi J B. So what happens is that if when I square psi, essentially, I get 1 minus 1 over lambda mu. So I've got two possibilities, essentially. Either lambda mu is larger than 1, I get some kind of attractive pattern. That means that this factor here will be larger, when I square, will be larger than 0. Or lambda mu is smaller than 1, I get some repulsive 1. So you will see later on what that means. For lambda mu equal 1, that corresponds to what you would expect if there were absolutely no correlation, for instance, just the identity matrix, then you get nothing, no contribution. So now, what is the contribution to the log likelihood of the data of mod number mu? Well, the calculation is easy to do, and that gives exactly this number, which is plotted here as a function of lambda, and we get this red curve. So that means that the big contribution comes from the very large eigenvalues, and that's exactly what people do when they look at PCA. For instance, you look at the correlation matrix, do PCA, take the largest modes, and do some kind of dimensional reduction. That's the usual way, simplest way of doing some kind of statistical analysis. But you see also that you can get very large contribution coming from very small eigenvalues. So very small eigenvalues are actually very informative about what is going on in the protein. And this is actually quite sensitive. It makes sense because if you think about it, how do you get a very small eigenvalue? So for instance, just suppose you have one variable and you just copy it exactly. So what you'd get is a zero eigenvalue because you get twice the same variable. They always take the same values, okay? So this zero eigenvalue tells you that there is a very strong constraint which corresponds to the fact that the two variables takes always the same values in all sequences. That's not a biological constraint. It's just a fake example which tells you how, I mean, you get this very strong information from very small eigenvalues. So if we look at the modes, sorry, we look at the modes with the largest and the smallest eigenvalues, we get these kind of things. So this is always for the same small trypsin inhibitor protein. So here you see the three largest eigenvalues. The values here are given of the lambdas. And here you see the modes corresponding to the smaller three eigenvalues. And so on vertical axis, I plot the pattern value, xi a, here. And the horizontal axis is some kind of discrete number, which correspond to, so the integer part is the number of a site, which goes from 0 to 52. And the fractional part here is the index of the amino acid divided by 21, OK? So it's just a way to plot the different components in one dimension. So let's look first at these top eigenvalue modes. So this one, actually, it's hard to see, but just believe me that you see a lot of big peaks here. And these peaks are very much correlated to the local conservation. When you see a very big peak, it means that you have a very large probability of seeing this amino acid A on site I. There is not much information in this top eigenvector here than simply the local conservation pattern, which is important, but has nothing to do with pairwise correlation, or very, very little to do. These two subsequent eigenvalues here, you see a lot of big values, I mean, component, at the beginning or at the end here, and it's a very regular spacing. Actually, if you look at the symbols here, that correspond to the gap symbols. So what does that mean? It means something very simple that people know. Usually, okay, I don't have a real multi-sequence alignment here, but I mean in real multi-sequence alignment, not all proteins have the same length. And what happens is that the length is highly variable at the beginning and the end of sequence. What I mean is that the conserved part, which is homologous across all the different organisms, is usually in the middle, while you may have some loss or some insertion at the beginning or at the end. And basically what we are saying here, what we are seeing is that we get a lot of pairwise correlation here coming from these long stretches of gaps at the end or beginning of the sequence. But again, that's a general property, statistical property of multi-sequence alignments, which have nothing to do with this particular protein. Now, on the contrary, if you look at the lowest eigenvalue, we get something which is much more interesting. And we get, for instance, for these 3 months here, essentially very small values, components, that are very close to zero. They're not zero, but very close to zero. And we get two big ones here, you see, which are basically opposite equal in magnitude, opposite in signs. And you get some kind of the same patterns here for these two other components. If you look at where they are localized, they are located here. They correspond to the sites and the amino acids. The amino acids are cysteine here, and the sites correspond to the different cysteine bridges in the protein. Cysteine-cysteine bridges are very strong, almost covalent links, bonds, which are very stabilizing for the protein structure. So it seems that the lowest eigenvalue modes correspond to this very strong constraint that you need the cysteine-cysteine in order to keep the structure. That's not exactly true, because if you look at the alignment, what you see is that for some sequences, you keep the same structure, but you don't have a cysteine-cysteine. You have another couple, or you have of amino acid, or you have gap-gap that have been deleted. So what we find here is that there is this mode here, and this mode actually implement our way to implement a very strong covariation condition. So we can have an interpretation of this mode here in the following, let's say, under some kind of truth table. So let's look only at the first line here, at the first table, sorry. So let's consider, for instance, this pattern here. You see, we have one strong negative and one strong positive. They are almost equal in amplitude and absolute value, but they have opposite signs. So what does that mean? That means that if So they correspond to one side I and one amino acid A for the first component, and another one J and B for the second one. And they satisfy this kind of relation. So that means if I put amino acid A, and if I put, let's say, neither A nor B on I and J, essentially what this term will be equal to zero here, because all the other components will be equal to zero. So the sum will be zero here. If I put, let's say, A on I, but I don't put B on J, one of the two components will count here. So this term will be large, and the other one will be zero. Okay, so I get, let's say, one if I normalize by the component value here, the absolute value. If I do the opposite, no and yes, I get a one, the same magnitude. And if I put two of them, then the two contributions will cancel each other, and I get a zero. Now, since this is a repulsive contribution, remember, since we have small eigenvalues, we get 1 minus 1 over lambda, so it's a negative term here in front here. So that means that we get a score, a contribution to the log likelihood, which is zero for these two cases here, which is negative in between. So the best case is either you have both amino acids on the two sides, which is the fourth line, or you have none of them on the two sides. So what this pattern is basically implementing is a logical exclusive OR function. And it's a very strong sign of covariation. You have either a couple of amino acids or another one, but you cannot have cross configuration. That's just impossible. So this is the meaning of these patterns. So if we look at in more details at the different modes, here you see as a function of the lambda here, the eigenvalues, we can have some measure of how similar to this kind of structure are the different modes. So one way to do that is to use a measure that people use in condensed matter physics, which is called the inverse participation ratio. So the inverse participation ratio is simply the sum of the force power of the components divided by the norm squared. So assume, for instance, that the patterns are normalized to unity, then in that case, we have simply the sum of the IA of xi IA to the force power. So it's a positive number, which scales in between, let's say, it can be one if we have only one component, which is one, and all the other ones are zero. So an extremely localized vector or pattern, and can be very small and scale as the inverse of a length if they are all equal. So the inverse participation ratio will be very large and close to unity if it's highly localized, and it will be very small, close to zero for large proteins, if it's really extended. The vector of the patterns is extended over the whole protein. And if we plot this inverse participation ratio as a function of lambda, you see that the large eigenmodes are extended. These two ones are correspond to the gaps. They are a little bit localized on the gaps only, while these ones here are you see, localized as the one I've shown before. And in fact, these ones are indicative of contacts on the structure because they correspond to very strong localized constraints, which are indicative of the structure. So this is how we got interested in looking at, let's say, localized eigenmodes. And in principle, well, it's easy. I mean, we just look at the correlation matrix coming from a multi-sequence alignment, diagonalize it, get this mode, look at whether we get this kind of picture and so on. So this is fine, except that in some cases, the number of sequences we have in the multi-sequence alignment is not so big. And then we run into the sampling problem, which is well known in random matrix theory. And just to remind you briefly of one case which is mathematically tractable, the spike covariance model. The problem is that if the amount of sampling you have is not sufficient compared to the signal in the population covariance matrix, then you won't be able to see it. So how is it, can it be stated? So suppose you have n Gaussian variables with the covariance matrix C, that's a population covariance matrix, has n minus 1 eigenvalues which are equal to unity. One of them is gamma. I will assume that gamma is larger than 1, but actually what I'm saying is also true for gamma smaller than 1. Then now assume I have T independent samples, and I will call R, let's say, the quality of sampling. So R is the ratio of the number of variables divided by the number of samples. So R equal to 0 means that there is no that's a perfect sampling. You have an infinite number of samples. So let's say basically it's a sampling noise. And we look at the spectral properties of the empirical correlation matrix here. So it's well known that if gamma is larger than some critical value, which is 1 plus square root of R, then we'll have one eigenvalue which comes out from the Martian capacitor spectrum here that Lossi described before. And this value here is reminiscent of the true value. So gamma hat is different from gamma, but that's something which is related to gamma and which depends on the on R. Well, if we are below this threshold here, then this mode is basically hidden inside the Martian capacitor spectrum and nothing can be seen. So this phase transition has been studied for a long time. And so what people have done also, they have computed, for instance, the overlap between the top eigenmode here in this strong signal case where you see one mode which comes out from the spectrum with the true eigenmode of the population covariance matrix. And there are well-known formulas. Of course, if you are below this threshold here, if gamma is smaller than 1 plus square root of R, the overlap is 0. And while if you are above, then you get a positive overlap here, which is given by these formulas, which means basically that you have enough data to guess essentially the direction of the right of the top eigenmode of the population covariance matrix. So one way to say that, just to say exactly the same thing, would be that if I look at some component of the true, let's say I would like to estimate the true eigenmode here, top eigenmode here, from the top eigenmode of the sample covariance matrix, then W1, which is given by this quantity here, is essentially not fluctuating in large size, large number of sample limits. So, so I can consider it as a constant given by this formula here. So essentially, if I know Xi1 hat, I've got some kind of Gaussian channel here. So the mutual information between Xi1 and Xi1 hat is given by this formula, is increasing above the threshold here. So what happens below the threshold? So below the threshold, we are in a bad situation because this overlap is 0. But the question is whether we still have some kind of information about the true top eigenmode from what is left. So below the threshold, essentially what I have is, so forget about this peak here. What I have when I look at the eigenspectrum of the C hat matrix is just a Martian capacitor spectrum. While the eigenspectrum of the true covariance matrix is this one. All eigenvalues are one except one which is equal to gamma. So what we can do is we can look at the overlap between the top eigenmode, which is the correct one, the population one, with the sample one, okay? And see what they look like. We expect them to be very small, and they scale as 1/√(n). And here you see the outcome of some numerical simulation corresponding to different sizes, which are, I think, 60, 120, and 240. And obviously, if you rescale the square overlap by n, all points fall on a single curve. And this single curve was computed first by Ledoix and Péché, to my knowledge, in 4 years ago. And here is the formula for the overlap. So what does that mean? That means that that's the average overlap between the top true eigenmodes, corresponding to eigenvalue gamma, and the empirical eigenmodes, which are correspond to eigenvalues, let's say lambda hat plus or minus epsilon. Okay? And that's given by this formula. And we have 1/(n) here. So this formula gives you something like that. So for instance, if you are below the threshold here, then you get this black curve here. Right at the threshold, this black curve will have some divergence here at the boundary of the Martian capacitor spectrum. And above the threshold, we get something similar to this case here, except that the integral of the W squared now is not normalized to 1, but it's 1 minus W1 squared, where W1 squared is the overlap of the two top eigenmodes, the population and the covariance matrix, which is now different from 0. OK, so basically, in this regime here, we have many, many small overlaps. So you see this curve is not flat. So something is going on. We have some signal here. So, but it's a very weak signal. So the question is whether actually from, so suppose we are below the threshold. So W1 is equal to 0 here. We don't have this term essentially. It's very small. So we have all these terms here. So the question is whether actually we have some information about the true top eigenmode from the knowledge of many, many small overlaps. So there are, each mode is very weakly informative, but we have many of them. So we can do some kind of toy replica calculation to see whether that gives something. So the toy replica calculation is very simple. What we do is that, so neglect this term here. Suppose I have a Gaussian variables here. I know the variance. So zero mean and the variance is known by the Ledoux-Péché formula. I have also Gaussian components here. I'm forgetting about all kinds of correlations, so it's just a very simple thing. And I would like to know what is the mutual information between these variables and this one. Okay? And if I do this calculation, I see that the mutual information is actually here. It's not zero. Okay? So we have the accumulation of a large number of order n, small overlap of order square root of n, gives something. So the question is, how can we exploit this mutual information in order to say something about the eigenmode? So obviously, if we work in the case of localized eigenmodes, okay, so just inspired by what I told you about proteins, one idea would be just to try to maximize the inverse participation ratio. That doesn't make any sense, because if we do that too much, then of course we'll get something fully localized on one component, and we'll have forgotten everything about the data. So we need to make some kind of trade-off between the prior, which is this maximization of IPR, and the likelihood. So the first thing we did was a very simple idea. So the likelihood, the log likelihood of these different patterns, of these different vectors may be complicated to compute, but let's do something very simple where we generate a discrete, a finite number of vectors. So we have a discrete set, not a continuous set of vectors, 2 to the n, so where n is the number of components, vector with equal likelihoods. And then in these slides of likelihood, fixed likelihood, we'll just try to maximize the IPR. So that we can do. So how we do that? So it's very simple. We do this very, rough approximation. So the WM, which is the overlap, we just replace by the square root of this, by the standard deviation. And sigma M is a sign, plus or minus one. Indeed, when we diagonalize the matrix, the sign of the eigenvector is completely arbitrary. So we can choose all the signs as we want. And we have 2 to the n different signs. And we are sure that all the corresponding vectors given by this will have equal likelihood. So among this set, we would like to maximize the IPR of, in a more, let's say, statistical physics language, to minimize the energy, which is minus the opposite of the IPR. And the configuration of these binary variables will give us some estimate of the top component. So that's very empirical. And in order to do that, we use simulated annealing. But the question is, you know, we just want to see whether we find something or not. So here is the outcome of the simulation for 80 variables. So you see here I plot as a function of gamma over gamma c, which is, so that's the critical value of gamma, and this is the eigenvalue, the signal eigenvalue. I plot here the square of the overlap between the true top eigenmode and the one of the matrix c hat. That would be the naive estimate. And we know it's going to be zero in the infinite size limit below the threshold and will be something positive above. In fact, for finite size system, you find something in good agreement. Now, what happens if we run this simulated annealing and find and maximize the IPR in this slice of equal likelihood eigenvectors? Well, we find the red dots here, which are definitely better. And the important point is that if we compare different sizes here, you see 10, 20, 50, 80 variables, they cross at some value here. And that's a strong indication, very empirical indication. Yes?
So here, the true dominant mode is sparse.
Yes, so here it's a highly localized one. Yes, absolutely. So this value of a threshold will depend on the vector, obviously. That's true. So that's the best case, okay, because it's very strongly localized. So it's a strong indication that some transition takes place here. And in the strong noise regimes, that, I mean, implementing this, I mean, using this prior information can help and find a vector which has a positive dot product with the true eigenmodes inside, when we are inside the bulk of the Marchenko-Pastor spectrum. So why does it fail if we are below this empirical threshold here? So is it a failure of the simulated annealing to find the ground state of the energy, the kind of Hamiltonian minus IPR? No, it's not. Actually, we can check that the ground state is found in most of the simulations. But I think it's much more similar to what happens in the Hofield model. So I don't know if you are familiar with the Hofield model. Maybe some of you are familiar. So the Hofield model was introduced a long time ago theoretical neurobiology. But basically, it's a model where you have a set of patterns, exactly the same kind of patterns I introduced before. and you have binary spins, and essentially the energy is minus the sum of the square of the magnetization along these directions. So configuration with good configuration, highly likely, configuration with high probability correspond to configuration with large magnetization along at least one of these specific directions, specific patterns. And here we have something very similar, because now the index of a component is the index of the eigenvector. And we have this sigma m here, which corresponds to this sigma j here. And the index of a pattern corresponds to the component, the original component index in our problem. And essentially, the IP error has exactly the same shape, same structure as this one, except that we are looking at the minus the sum of the fourth power of magnetization. So the change, so that means that, of course, since we have, instead of power 2, we have power 4, that means that we may expect first order transition. I'll talk about that in a couple of minutes. But basically, the two formulas are very similar. And people know, have been knowing for a long time, the phase diagram of the Hopfield model, in particular at very low temperature, and this is the regime where we are, because the simulated annealing is supposed to find the ground state. It's well known that as a function of the amount of quench disorder, I mean, the number of patterns here, or if you want, the amount of sampling noise R, that means that would be basically the amount, the sampling noise R. If you prefer, let's say that you have, if you fix R, you say that you will be here in very high gamma, so very large signal, and here a weak signal. Then there is a phase transition here at some, along this boundary here, which corresponds to a change of behavior, qualitative change of behavior in this model, where the pattern configuration, one pattern configuration is a ground state of the system when you are in this weak noise region here. And here it's not a ground state, it's not an absolute minimum anymore, it's a local minimum only. And basically, we think this is exactly what we see here in this problem. In this regime here, we see that the ground state corresponds to a good configuration, that is with the positive overlap with the true eigenvector. While if we are in this region, probably that corresponds to this one here, probably if we start with some configuration of spins, these plus minus one variables which are close to the solution, then in a small basin of attraction, we will converge to it, otherwise we will never find it. So there are other evidences for this transition, and I want to cite this recent paper by Andrea and collaborators. So Andrea looked at a different case, not case where the prior information is related to localization, but to non-negative components. So the problem is the following. So again, we look at the spike covariance model, where we have one mode here corresponding to the signal eigenvalue, gamma, which is larger than one. And all the components of psi are positive. And you can build some empirical correlation matrix on that. And the question, can you infer this top eigenmode here from C hat? So in principle, well, if you have in the generic case, it's easy to you can choose this vector here, V, and you know that the dot product between V and Xi will be positive. That works in many cases. Unless Xi is sparse, which is the interesting and hard case, because if Xi is sparse, the number of components here is going to be small, especially, for instance, if you have a finite number of non-zero components. And when n is large, then you don't get any positive dot product anymore, OK? So that's a hard case. So so Montanari and Richard showed that if you solve the problem, the optimization problem, that you want to consider the quadratic form built from C hat under the condition that all the components of the vector should be positive, then the outcome of this product, the vectors, which is solution of this optimization problem, then has a dot product with the true eigenmode, the one of C, which is positive, provided the noise level, R, is smaller than twice gamma minus 1 squared, if I'm correct. And so it's interesting because, you know, if you do just naive estimate, you just look at the top eigenmode of this matrix without any condition here, you will find exactly the same result without the two. So the fact that you have two here means that you can, handle larger amount of noise and essentially that you are below the BBP or, let's say, this transition threshold, OK? So that's interesting. So the question we ask is whether actually we can have some kind of general result for the localized prior we are interested in mostly, but also in this case, can we recover this with the general formalism and any kind of prior? So again, the problem is the following. You have a matrix, and we assume that we have only one signal, eigenmode. We build this empirical correlation matrix. And I like to look at the posterior distribution of this vector xi. Okay. So the likelihood of this correlation matrix is given by the Wishart distribution, which is well known in random matrix theory, and is given by this formula. So as far as xi is concerned, you see xi will be somewhere here, essentially. And so basically what I will have to do, so it appears only here because here it depends only on gamma, not on xi. So basically this formula tells me that the posterior distribution of xi will be given by this. I'm assuming here that there is no prior. I will insert the prior a little bit later. And I write the prefactor here as r, the amount of noise. So I would like to put it explicitly here because the number of configuration here can be as large as I want. So if I put r in front of it, that will basically normalize the whole thing to the number of variables, n. And there is this factor here, which is plays a role in statistical mechanics of some inverse temperature. And if you do the computation, it's very easy. It's 1 minus 1 over the eigenvalue, which is basically the formula we had when I talk about the proteins. We had this 1 minus 1 over lambda. That's the same formula. It's not, I mean, it's not a coincidence. It has to be the same thing. So I will consider a more general measure where I take exactly the same kind of quadratic form, but instead of this specific value beta, I will have any kind of beta. So I can choose this value, but I can choose, for instance, beta equal to plus infinity if I want to do maximum posteriori decoding, or maximum likelihood decoding, there is no prior here. Or I can do also beta going to minus infinity if I want to look at the mode with the smallest eigenvalue. I can play with beta as I want. Okay. So now, if we have some prior information, I would like to modify this formula for the likelihood with some prior, and I will consider a case where the prior is simply a function of a component of the eigenvector. So let's consider some kind of penalty potential V, which will encode the kind of information I have. So for instance, in the case of localization, V will be equal to zero if xi is very small, and it will be large and negative. So it's a negative penalty, so that means it helps. If xi is large. And that counts essentially the IPR. If you do the sum of the I of V of xi, that's basically the IPR. And we have V0, which is the strength of this potential. But of course, you can have different prior. You can have the non-negative one, which corresponds to this case, where V0 is sent to plus infinity if you have a half constraint. And you can consider also sparse, or let's say L1 terms, which would correspond to this potential. And you can put whatever you want, as long as it depends only on the component. So for the reason that Simona explained in her talk, we believe that actually that's not a very good prior for proteins because there is no reason why the interaction matrix should be sparse. And probably there is no reason why the eigenmodes also of the correlation matrix should be sparse. So how do we do this kind of calculation? So we like to understand this measure here, rho of xi. So I have 5 more minutes. Yeah. So basically, we need to understand this measure here. And we use classical statistical physics tool. Essentially, we look at this normalization here and assume that it's highly concentrated around some value when n is large. And compute the moments of z for integer value of m and do some kind of continuation for m going to 0. So there is, obviously, that's not a rigorous technique, but it was shown in the celebrated case of a Schoenfeld quadratic model to give correct results some years ago, and recently with some recent results by Panchenko. So no mathematical control, but probably the results I'm going to show are correct. So when we do that, basically what we get are two other parameters, which are these ones here. So just to be sure everything is clear, Cij here is the population covariance matrix. The bracket here means the average of a row at fixed data. The data are inside C hat here. And the over bar here means the average over the samples. So the average over C hat, if you prefer. And we have these two other parameters. And what the replica calculation gives us is a set of self-consistent equations for Q0 and Q1. So what do this quantity means? mean? Well, the first one, Q0, interesting because it's essentially proportional to what we are interested in, which is the dot product between the true eigenvector of the population covariance matrix and the one we can sample, we can obtain from this measure here. And the other one should be equal to 0 because you see we have some kind of even distribution here. So in principle, that should be 0. The average of xi should be 0 unless we have some symmetry breaking, which means that the system, basically the distribution will be essentially magnetized or let's say peaked around the localized modes we want to infer. And then in that case, we have a non-zero and interesting value for Q1. So just briefly, I just want to give you some very brief idea of what we can find in the case of localization. So the phase diagram should be a diagram in the three-dimensional space where we have this inverse temperature beta. We have R, which is the amount of sampling noise, and V0, which is the strength of a potential. And I fix here the signal eigenvalue gamma. So the simplest case corresponds to no potential at all. Then we know the answer. In the case of beta going to infinity, that corresponds to the formulas I gave before. And if you do as a function of beta, what you find is a phase boundary between the aligned and the not aligned regimes that correspond to this regime here, to this orange curve here. And you will find back the exact value for the threshold here, the BBP threshold. And more precisely, you can compute this overlap here as a function of at fixed R, as a function of beta, and find how it corresponds to this temperature and so on. So we can have plenty of things. Now, what happens when we have this prior, which is an interesting case? So just to give you a flavor of what is going on, I will look at the beginning of a curve here. You see there is a boundary between the aligned and the not aligned, which corresponds, if I send R, the sampling noise, to 0, but I send also this bias beta, this inverse pressure to 0, there will be a slope here, a critical slope, which is 1 over gamma I minus 1 in the absence of any prior. So the question is how this slope will change as a function of the prior strength, and we would expect the slope to increase because if we have some prior, if a prior helps, then of course the amount of noise we can handle should be larger, okay? So, in fact, we can compute this slope here. So this is beta prime, beta equal, beta over R as a function of V0, and we get this kind of curve. So this is a critical value, 1 over gamma minus 1 I talked about before. And we find different kind of curves here. So this curve here depends on the true top component. So it's not universal at all. It depends on the structure here. So in order to have very simple formulas, I use k-sparse for sake of simplicity, but we have explicit formulas for we have some formulas, not explicit, but we have some formulas to solve for other cases. And what is interesting to some extent here is that along this curve, there will be transitions which are second order or first order. Means that above this value, 1/4 of k here, where k is the amount of non-zero components in the trigon vector, then the transition here will be first order when you go from zero overlap to some finite overlap. We can extend, obviously, the phase diagram to negative beta and to larger V0. You see, if you have very strong V0 here, very strong prior, you will get always something which is localized, but with negative beta, for instance, then it will be localized along any direction which is not the right one. So it depends on the sign of the eigenvalue. It will be reversed if the eigenvalue is smaller than 1. So I have to stop. So now what happens if we are not at small noise and small beta, but we have, let's say, big beta and finite noise. So we will have to find the whole surface, boundary surface, which is complicated. So I did something simpler just for the sake here of the presentation. So in the plane, so let's say if we fix R, let's look at what happens when we do some kind of maximum a posteriori inference. So we send beta and V0 to infinity with some finite ratio, the slope S. And we can do that in different planes that correspond to different values of R. And we see what happens. So basically, just to give you a flavor of what is going on, for R smaller than gamma minus 1 squared, we find, starting from S equal to 0, which corresponds to the absence of prior, so this is the value of the overlap W1 squared I mentioned before, we find some value which depends on the value of K, the sparsity, because If k is equal to 1, then it will increase with s. If k is smaller than 1, then it can decrease because at some point only one component will remain active, which is small compared to k. The interesting thing is that if r is larger than gamma minus 1 squared, which is, let's say, below the BBP transition, then we get a first order phase transition at a finite value of s. Yes, I'm done. And we have an explicit expression for a k-sparse vector, and it might be complicated for any kind of vector. So that means we can beat also again this BBP threshold in this particular case. Okay, so let me stop now. So the prior helps to beat spike covariance model threshold. Okay, that might not be very surprising. If you put prior information, you do better. So the question, I think, maybe, so it can be useful, but the question is whether it's really interesting or not. I'm not sure. The question maybe is something generic comes out from this kind of study could be interesting. So for instance, can we say something generic about the order of a phase transition or depending on the kind of regularity of the prior of this potential V, do we get some generic behavior? What is the shape of the surface? We don't have any good understanding, generic understanding of that so far. So I haven't said anything about the computational point of view, which is very interesting and important. So but we haven't done nothing about that. What we would like to do now, I mean, from a more practical point of view, is to apply in these kind of things to see whether that helps. And one interesting case would be maybe even more interesting from some point of view than from point of view of structural biology than proteins is RNA, because RNA is even in a worse situation than proteins in terms of prediction, structural prediction. And so in RNA, you have a single polymer which folds into itself. And this polymer have a secondary structure which then makes a tertiary structure. This is just one example here. And most of the covariation signal is due to the secondary structure here, which is extremely strong. The tertiary structure, which corresponds to this contact here, is extremely weak and very hard to find from the correlation matrix itself. So it's important to develop techniques which are, let's say, more refined than the one used for proteins in this particular case. That may help. Okay? Yes, so I, as I said, I haven't tried. So the examples I gave here, again, I mean, I'm not trying to do sparse things. I use sparse vectors here just because it's easier for the formulas to plot some curve, right?
But you do localize.
I do localize, but localize, so we had some.
So what is the difference?
Yeah, we had some email about that, but yes. Okay, sparse means that you have zeros, a lot of zeros.
No.
Okay, so I don't know what sparse means. Okay. So with your definition of sparse, then this is my definition of localized. Okay. I thought that sparse meant a lot of zeros. Okay, so that's fine. So we agree.
Any further questions? All right, let's take, oh, sorry.
Yes. So the question is how you can. Yes. So the question is how can you subtract this signal, which is basically dominating the covariance matrix, in order to capture the tertiary one. I'd like to be able to comment. No, I'm not able to comment, but to say anything which I really believe in. But I mean, it's a very important issue, of course. I mean, I don't know how it depends on the potential. I mean, this one doesn't look very nice if you see that, you know, because you want to peek along the boundaries of a cube. But we haven't tried so far to see what happens, only even from a purely empirical point of view.
Very quickly.
Could you say that again, please? No, so we have tried on ribosomes. Okay, we haven't tried on silencing RNA. But silencing RNA, would you expect a very strong testary structure? I mean, that's not obvious to me. Well, okay, it will, maybe if you have some examples of families in mind, that would be great. I would be very happy to discuss that. Yeah, I mean, it's not even clear that in some cases, maybe the secondary structure is very important, or just the complementary structure to messenger RNA or things like that, but you're right, I mean. Okay, yeah. Okay, so maybe we can discuss about some specific families. That would be great.
All right, now let's thank the speaker again.